Thank you, Manda. Professor Findlay, the Executive Dean of the Faculty of the Professions, Professor Jeff Harcourt and his wife Joan, Harcourt donors, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our Bragg's Lecture Theatre and thank you for joining us for the annual Harcourt Lecture presented by the School of Economics. The Harcourt Visiting Professorship was established by generous donations in recognition of the 25 years of infectious enthusiasm and distinguished scholarship which Jeff Harcourt gave the School of Economics. Professor Harcourt began his career in Adelaide as a lecturer in economics in 1958, leaving in 1982 for Cambridge University. His distinguished career brought numerous awards, including being made an Officer of the Order of Australia. And now, in honour of Jeff Harcourt and his significant contribution, each year the School of Economics invites a global leader in the field of economics to share their knowledge and experience, not only with the economic students and staff, but also the broader community. The Harcourt Visiting Professorship has enabled interaction with some of the leading academics around the world. And this has helped foster an intellectual environment, injected new ideas and provided exposure to the frontiers of economic research. Such visiting professorships are a window to the world. They also provide the school with an opportunity to showcase its own talent and strengths to prominent scholars in the field, helping attract new recruits, building connections for our students, and integrating our school into the global network of economics, the economics research fraternity. This year, we're delighted to welcome Professor Lise Vesterlund. Professor Vesterlund is the Mellon Professor of Economics at the University of Pittsburgh. She earned a BA in Economics from the University of Copenhagen and an MA and PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Professor Vesterlund has been involved with the National Bureau of Economic Research in the US since 2011 and is an associate or co-editor of a number of prominent economics journals. Her research focuses on understanding how and why we give to charity and on why men are more successful than women in climbing the corporate ladder. Her lecture tonight, Sustaining the Glass Ceiling Through Gender Differences in Belief and Behaviour, covers a topic of great importance for the workplace. So we're very privileged to welcome her here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2014 Jeff Harcourt Visiting Professor, Professor Lise Vesterlund.
Good evening. Thank you so much for inviting me. It's my first opportunity to be in Australia, and so far it has been magnificent. Everything is beautiful, everybody's kind. So far I've had a good time. I hope it continues after this talk. So, but the talk I'm going to give tonight reflects on a number of papers that I've written. And really, so for a long time, I've been very interested in trying to understand why it is, despite the fact that men and women seem to be going to college at the same rate, seem to be getting the same education, we still have a very hard time sort of breaking through the glass ceiling. So when we look at the achievements that men and women have in the labor market, on one hand, we see very substantial wage gaps, we see lots of horizontal segregation between men and women, but what is most striking when we look at the labor market is really that men and women succeed in climbing the corporate ladder in very different ways. And this is throughout the world. It's a very big issue in the US. It's a very big issue in Australia, where if you look, the most recent numbers suggest that 18% of board members are females out of the largest companies in Australia. But it's even a big issue in Denmark, where we really pride ourselves of treating men and women equally. So this is a global phenomenon, and we continue to struggle to understand what gives rise to it. And in trying to understand what gives rise to these differences, we've sort of been coming at it, at the problem in many different ways. And I think one of the ways that might help to think about it is to think about what it is that leads to promotions for men and women. So typically, if somebody gets promoted, it's because they perform tasks that people notice their performance on. So if you want to get promoted, you need to have promotable tasks in your portfolio, and you want to avoid the non-promotable tasks. So you don't want to be stuck in the office doing the things that nobody pays any attention to. This is something, this whole issue of looking at task allocation is something that we just recently have started investigating. There are a couple of surveys that suggest that indeed women do end up with more non-promotable tasks. Sort of what strikes closest to home is probably looking in academia. And in academia, there have been a number of studies that show that women more than men end up with lots and lots of committee work. There is one study from 2011 that showed that women spend 7.5 hours less on research per week and almost 5 hours more on committee work. If you want to be promoted at a university, that kind of time allocation is going to hurt you. There's a study very recently done in political science that showed that women faculty more than male faculty ended up supervising undergraduates and ended up with sort of token tasks in terms of committee assignments. So once again, that is not something that will get them promoted. If we go into industry, there is similar evidence. There is an interesting survey looking at engineering graduates from prominent schools like MIT, trying to understand why is it that these female students who are graduating from the best possible schools in engineering, why do they drop out of engineering? And one of the things that they found was that the reason why they dropped out, or the reason why they weren't excited about continuing their engineering degree, was in part that they were given tasks that were not the type of tasks that they thought that they had been trained for. So they ended up giving female roles and becoming managers of smaller tasks, which was not what they hadn't expected. So we're seeing some evidence that indeed task allocations seem to differ between men and women. And of course, there are many reasons why tasks could differ in the workplace, just like there could be many reasons why men and women have different positions in the workplace. For one, it could be that men and women have different preferences. There's nothing wrong with men and women having different preferences. Many females or the primary caregiver at home, that's going to prevent them from doing some of the things that they also want to do at work. If it's only a question of preferences, there's nothing for any of us to do. If women don't want to climb the corporate ladder, and if there's nobody there who wants them to climb the corporate ladder, then all is good. It could be that women are not good managers. It could be that they're not very good at performing the promotable tasks. If that's what's driving the difference, then there's no reason for us to be looking at. This is a free world. People can do what they want. Of course, another reason could be differential treatment. It could be discrimination. If it's discrimination, then obviously we should be concerned. What I'm going to talk about tonight is that it could be something more than this. So this is not to diminish the fact that there could be ability and preference differences or that there could be discrimination. But it could also be that men and women respond differently to the process that leads to promotion. And the two things that I will talk about are studies that I've done suggesting both that men and women respond differently to competition, and more recent work that suggests that men and women differ in their ability to say no to requests. Okay, and why is that important? Well, if you think about the tasks that would lead to promotion, if you're very competitive, you're gonna lean in and grab the promotable tasks. If you're very bad at saying no to requests in the workplace, you're gonna, so on one hand, competitiveness will lead to the promotable tasks. Inability to say no will get you stuck at the non-promotable tasks. So what I will talk about is how we've been trying to identify whether or not there indeed are these gender differences in competitiveness and ability to say no. But you can see if there are differences that it can help explain why men and women might differ in their ability to climb the corporate ladder. Okay, so starting with competitiveness, the research that I've done there is together with my co-author Muriel Needley at Stanford. And what we wanted to understand was if we took all the other differences that there are between men and women away, should we expect men and women to succeed in the workplace at the same rate? So, you know, as it was mentioned, I do experimental economics in part because it gives us controllable insights into what could be driving some of these effects. Once we see things in the lab, then we can take them to the field and investigate more how robust these findings are. But finding things in the lab gives us deep insights to what could be driving these factors to begin with. So what we did was that we had groups of two men and two women seated in a row, and we told them, you're going to be given a task. Your task is to add up 5 two-digit numbers as many times as you possibly can. You have 5 minutes to do it. Now, you're going to do this under different incentive schemes. First, in one task, you're going to get paid 50 cents every time you solve one of these problems. Once you've done that for 5 minutes, you know how much you earn, then we're going to tell you, you're sitting in this row with three other people. Now you're going to solve as many problems as you can, and the one of you who solves the most is going to get $2 per problem. So they do this, and then we get to this third task, and we say, now you get to do it one more time, but you get to pick. Do you want to do it one more time under the piece rate, the non-competitive scheme, or do you want to enter a competition where you only get paid if you solve more problems than the other people? So what we found was, first of all, which is a big relief, men and women are equally good at adding up 5 two-digit numbers. Okay? So there are no differences in performances, and there are no differences in how many problems they solve when they're in a competition. Okay, we can all solve these problems. Where the striking finding comes is when we then say, now you get to pick. We have men and women, they did exactly the same, and now they get to pick what they want to do. And what we see is this complete separation between men and women. 73% of the men go into the competition, only 35% of the women go into the competition. So the question is, why? Why are we seeing this gap? Well, obviously it's not driven by performance, because there was no difference in performance. If we look at how well they, whether or not they entered conditional on performance, so one on the bottom here is the top quartile, so it's the top 25%. And you can see that even among the top quartile, so the women are on the bottom, you can see they enter very little. They're not very responsive to how good they actually were. But the best performing women are entering the competition less than the worst performing men. Okay? Now, that's a problem if this is reflective of what happens in business, right? Because you want the best performing women to go into the competition. You want to be able to select among the best performing women. Okay? Now, what could be driving it? Why are we seeing this? Well, one thing is how good you are, another thing is how good you think you are. So then we went back and we said, out of this group of four people, how good do you think you are? Okay? Now, what we see when we ask them that is out of 40 men, you ask 40 men, do you think you are first, second, third, or fourth? 75% of them say, I think I was best. Okay? Now, needless to say, given that everybody performed the same, that number should be 10. Okay? So the men are extremely overconfident, and of course they're wrong a lot of the time. But that helps explain why they go in, because they're convinced that they're the best. Okay? Now, women, we often talk about women not being confident. It's not that women are not confident, they're just not as overconfident as the men. Okay? So part of the reason why we're seeing this gap in entry into the competition is coming from the fact that the men are more overconfident. Okay? But even when we condition on how good you think you are, so if I look at the very best perform, the people who thought that they were best, I see that the men enter the tournament about 30 percentage points more than the women who thought that they were best. So there are two components here. One is that the men are more overconfident. Second component is conditional on your belief, women shy away from the competition relative to men. So the men are more eager to go into the competition. Sorry. So why does this matter? It matters because at the end of the day, we end up with few high-performing women entering into the competition. Okay, so if we tend to see women not leaning in, that would result in them not securing the promotion. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this study is, you know, we do these things in the lab. Recent results show that your willingness to compete in this task, several years after going back to the same people, Your willingness to compete in this task predicts your future income. It predicts the major that you select. So you know, we're picking up something that is more than we're just uncovering competitiveness in solving 5 two-digit numbers, okay? So that certainly suggests, which is sort of the argument that has been going on, at least in the popular press in the US, is that women don't lean in enough. Right? Women should be leaning in, they should be trying to go for the prize. I mean, you could also take another perspective and say, well, maybe it's more of an institutional question that we should be asking ourselves. Are the managers that we want really overconfident and super competitive individuals? If I had a business, I think maybe having somebody who was extremely overconfident wouldn't be the ideal manager. But that's a different side of the story. But let's try to go to the non-promotable task, because we've been focused so much on women not giving it all. So how do we get started thinking about the non-promotable task? So when you think about non-promotable tasks, what are non-promotable tasks? They're tasks that you don't necessarily have to do. So the question is, when something shows up, suppose that an office mate is sick, a task needs to be done. Anybody in the office can do it. Maybe it's taking notes at a meeting. The task has to be accomplished, but nobody wants to do it. And the question is, who ends up doing it? Whenever I go to promotion and tenure meetings at the University of Pittsburgh, we sit around a big table and the dean says, who's going to chair the meeting and write the report? That is not a promotable task. Nobody will pay any attention to whether or not you volunteer to do that task, but it will be noted if nobody volunteers to do it. Okay. And the question is, who is it who steps up to take that non-promotable task? And who is it who gets tapped to do the non-promotable task? Sadly, in my case, it is often me. Okay, so in fact, it got so bad that some of the women that I've done the subsequent study with, we actually, years ago, formed what we called the No Club. Okay. So what is the No Club? No Club, number one, you need to have a little bit of wine. That makes it easier. Number two, you meet and you talk about the things that you say yes and no to. So you're held accountable. So whenever you say yes to something, you need to come up with something else that you're going to say no to. So after years of going over this, talking about, you know, why is it when a graduate student comes in at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon and say that you need to write a letter of recommendation before Monday, that you say sure. So thinking about every time you say yes, what are the things that you will say no to? In my case, it often ends up being my family. So after thinking about this for a long time, another wonderful example, one of the women in the No Club is actually a dean. And despite being a dean, she had developed this interesting behavior where every time she would go to a meeting, she would bring a pad of paper and a pen, and she would make sure the notes were taken so everybody remembered what they should do. Surprisingly, nobody else brought a pad of paper and a pen. So she had to do it for every meeting because nobody else was going to do it. So after thinking about this for a while, three of the women in this club are also interested, has done previous research in gender. We started wondering whether or not this was a gender phenomenon. And it was hard to really, there are very few people you talk to who say that they're not overcommitted, right? So this need not be a gender phenomenon, but we wanted to try to study that. And in thinking about that, it's clear that if we're going to see women end up with more non-promotable tasks, it could be coming from many sides. It could be because they're asked more. It could be because they volunteer more. It could be when they're asked, they agree to do it more. So we sort of need to get at this both from the demand and the supply side. So, the things that we've done to uncover this is first to see whether or not, are there differences in attitudes? Do men and women respond differently to when they're asked to do something that they don't want to do? Do they experience that in different ways? Is it easier for the male to say no than it is for the female? Then we conducted a field study to see whether or not women and men who get the same request via email, do they respond differently? And then finally, we've gone into a laboratory to sort of uncover what's going on. And we've done that both in seeing when you just have to volunteer, do women step up more than men? And if you're not just volunteering, if somebody taps you, are women asked more than men? And when they're asked, do they volunteer to do it more? Okay, so let's first look at the supply side. So looking at the supply side, and I'll do this very quickly. Going out and asking people, we've done this through a number of different surveys. This is still not the final survey, but just to give you a sense, the results that we're finding do suggest that men and women, when they're asked to do something that they really don't want to do, that they experience it differently. So thinking about something, we ask MBAs to think about a time when they were asked to do something at work that they really didn't have to do and they wanted to say no. How did they feel? Women more than men reported feeling worn out. They felt more worried. They felt pressured to say yes. It was difficult for them to say no. They were worried that they would be seen as somebody who was not helpful. And in general, they felt like they did too many things at work. Okay. In a subsequent study, we asked them once again, think about a time at work when you were asked to do something where you just wished that the person hadn't come into your office. Right? This is not something that you're excited about. You wish that it hadn't come in to be a request of you. How did you feel? Once again, we see the same thing. Women, when they get these requests, report more negative emotions. They feel worn out, stressed, overwhelmed. And when they think about why they would say yes, they're more likely to say, part of the reason why I'm going to say yes is because I'm worried about what will happen if I say no. So those are really the differences that we're seeing in responses. Now, what does it mean that we find differences in responses? Well, you know, at least we're finding some differences in the survey measures, but it doesn't mean that behavior is different. When I come home from work and my husband, if I say to my husband, how was your day? His day is pretty much always fine. My day, there is not hardly anything I'm not worried about. Okay, so just because we are finding in the survey measures that women are reporting being more worried doesn't necessarily mean that behavior is different. Okay, so let's look at the actual behavior. So it turns out that Craig Fox and David Tannenbaum at UCLA had done a large study, not interested in gender, where they looked at whether or not people would volunteer to serve on faculty senate. I don't know if you're a faculty senate here, but I can assure you, at most US institutions, you do not want to serve on faculty senate. Okay, this is not a promotable task. You only want to do it if you have some very strong preference to spend time with other people who want to be there as well. Okay, so they sent out all these requests, and they said, do you want to serve on these committees for faculty senate? And what did they find? So we got the data and we looked at gender differences. And across the board, we find number one, this is not something that people are excited about. Men in general say no. More than 95%, independent of category, say no, I don't want to be on faculty senate. They don't even say I don't want to be on faculty senate. They just don't respond. Women across the board are more likely to agree to be on faculty senate. Okay. Now, that doesn't necessarily, maybe women just more than men enjoy being with other people who want to be on faculty senate. So the reason why we need to take it to the lab is that we don't know what is driving this. So let's take it into the laboratory. So in setting up this design, we wanted to start off and say, imagine if we're in an environment where we have a group of people, we're back at my promotion and tenure meeting, the dean is sitting there and saying, who's going to step up to the task? And the question is, who's going to step up? So you're faced with a request from a group. It's a non-promotable task. And the question is, who is going to step up to do the task? So every member of the group, of course, prefers that somebody else does it. But the group in general agrees that it's a dominant strategy for somebody to do it. Okay. So there are many, many different names for this particular game. You can call it Game of Chicken, you can call it the Dragon Slayer game by Bliss and Nailbuff, you can call it the Volunteer's Dilemma. It all comes down to the same thing. So here's how we did it. We bring a bunch of subjects into the lab. They get paired in groups of three. And then they're told, you don't know exactly who you're paired with, it's just other people in the room. And then you're told you have 2 minutes to make a decision. All of you are going to get a screen that has a red button on it. If none of you click that button, you each get a dollar. If you click the button, you get $1.25. And the two other members of your group get $2. So clearly somebody should just click the button. Right? This is like sitting in a hot room, somebody should just open the window and be done with it. The question is, who's going to open the window? Right? So it's a dominant strategy. If nobody else is going to do it, you will open the window. The question is to figure out who is going to open the window. Okay? And this is one of these times when it would be nice to actually record things in the laboratory, because it gets incredibly tense. Remember, the students that we have are all undergraduates. This is the first time in our laboratory. 2 minutes for a freshman is pretty close to an eternity. Okay, so they do this for 10 rounds. They're randomly repaired every round. And the question, of course, is why not? You know, number one, do they even succeed in clicking the button? Do they just wait and let this big surplus disappear in front of their eyes because they can't figure out who's going to click? Okay, so this is the screen. They sit there, time is counting down in the top corner. You know how many seconds you have left? If it goes to zero, you're done. Everybody gets a dollar, you move on to the next round. Okay, and the question is why not somebody's gonna click that red button? The minute somebody clicks, you're done. And you can move on to the next round. Okay, so this is the game. Do they succeed in investing? Absolutely. Okay, so of course this is a coordination game. There are lots of different equilibria. There's a pure strategy equilibrium where one person invests, nobody else invests. There are asymmetric equilibria where two people invest 40% and the other person never invests. There's a symmetric mixed strategy equilibria. So there are lots of equilibria, and we need to figure out how we're going to coordinate and play the game. But they do pretty well. They get investments about 80% of the time. Now, of course, what we're interested in is, are there differences in the rate at which people are investing? Are there differences in the propensity to which you step forward? So this is not because you think faculty senate is enjoyable. You're accepting a lower pay and securing higher pay for somebody else. And the question is, who's going to do that? So number one, of course, what is easy to see in this game, people are going to wait until the very end before they click. They're sitting around, they're waiting, and most of the investments happen at the very end. Who do the investments happen from? This is the propensity by women. So they invest slightly more than a third of the time. What about men? From the very beginning, men are investing less than women. And it persists. It's not as if you get to the ninth round for a male and you say, I really haven't invested, I'm going to step up. They stay low the whole time. Now, if we look over the number of times out of the 10 rounds that you end up clicking the button, what you can see are very large differences between men and women. Okay? There are women who click 8 times out of the 10. Okay? So every time the screen comes up, they say, somebody should open the window. Somebody should really open the window. OK, I'll open the window. Next time comes around, the female is opening the window again. Okay, so we see very large differences. If you sort of say, out of the 10 rounds, the fair split is to do 3 or more, women are way above that. And the males, on the other hand, are staying below that. Okay, so the way that the success rate is secured is by women clicking the button. Okay? Now, the question is, of course, why? Why are the women clicking the button? Now, there are lots of reasons you could imagine this happening. Maybe women just care more about people. Maybe women are more risk averse. Maybe they're more conforming. So we have a bunch of survey measures. We put them in. We have incentivized measured. We control for them. None of it explains anything. So the question is, why? Well, one of the things that could be happening is a question of beliefs, right? So we know that we're playing these types of coordination games. Having heterogeneous populations through evolutionary theory can result in us playing asymmetric equilibria, right? So one of the ways that we can play with beliefs, what's very hard about doing gender is that you don't want to go in and tell subjects in a laboratory experiment, we're interested in looking at gender. So playing with beliefs is hard. So the one way that we could play with it is to say, let's do the same experiment again. But let's make sure that all the subjects who arrive are female. And if it's a question of beliefs, if it is a question of the men expecting the women to click the button, if the men are expecting the women to click the button, the women have to click the button. But I can play with those beliefs if I just have women show up. Because then they will look around the room and they will say, oh, the girls are here. They're going to click the button. I don't have to click it so much. On the other hand, if it's a bunch of males in the room, if they look around and they realize that the girls aren't there, the only way they're going to get the investment is to click the button. Now, another, except for just playing with beliefs, another fun thing about this additional treatment is that what we saw in our first study, because women are more likely to click the button, is when, without knowing it, people ended up being groups with three women, they almost get 100% success rate. If you end up with three males, they don't do so well. So just out of curiosity, it would also be fun to see if the males simply self-destruct, okay? Now, that's not completely kosher, but let's see if they self-destruct, okay? So that's what we do. We run single-sex sessions. We have all males, all females come in. So this is the success rate we got from mixed gender. And the question is, how well do the girls do? Does it become this utopia where everybody clicks a button and everything is wonderful? No. Girls don't get there, okay? They do no better when they're by themselves. What about the males? Do they crash and self-destruct? No, absolutely not. They know how to click the button, okay? They just don't click the button when the girls are there, okay? So what happens is that the female investment rate and the male investment rate becomes exactly the same when they're by themselves, okay? What's somewhat interesting is also that they get there in very different ways. So even though the investment rate is the same, the way they get there is different. If I look at the investment rate for females, and that would be your left, what happens when I take them into single sex sessions is that the whole distribution shifts to the left, okay? And there's a high frequency of sort of doing the fair share. If I look at the men, when the men are by themselves, the way they get to the same investment rate is not by going for a fair share. The way they get to the same investment rate is that the free-riding men don't respond at all. The males who never invest or invest once, it doesn't matter if they're males or females in the room, they never invest. But what happens to the males who were investing a little bit, they look around the room and they realize that they have to become these super-clicking guys in order to get to the same outcome, okay? So even though we get same investment rates, the two groups get there in very different ways, okay? So for these super clicking guys, they really want the girls around. So that's what we're seeing. So we're seeing women just stepping up to the request. So the next question is then to say, well, if it really is beliefs, then we should see people, if they have an opportunity to ask, then we should see the girls being asked more, okay? So the way we're gonna do this is that we're now going to say, suppose we have a fourth person. He's not in the group, he can't click the button. But he gets to see the pictures of the three people in the group. And he gets to point to one of them and say, you know, I think you should invest. And then we play the same game. We play for 2 minutes again. Anybody can click the button. But one person has been pointed at. And the person who points gets $2 if he can just get somebody in the group to invest, and $1 if he doesn't succeed in getting the group to invest. So now the question is, who do they click on? So, number one, we can see this is the likelihood that you invest. You're much more likely to invest if you've been pointed to, okay? The other thing that we see, which you sort of would expect, this is a coordination game. Getting somebody to point to you makes it easier to coordinate, okay? So the success rate for these groups go up. It helps to come into the office and say, I think you should do it, rather than just saying somebody should take this task. And part of the way you can see that is that investments, rather than waiting to the very end, about a third of the investments happen right away. Somebody points to you, you invest. Of course, the question is, who do they point to? So this is what the images look like. These are not undergraduates. These are graduate students, because we can't show pictures of the undergraduates who were in the study. So you are the fourth person. You're presented with the three members in your group. And you get to click the person that you want. Okay. If we have two men and one, of course, we can only look at gender differences when there's one of each, right? So the question is, who are they going to click? 40% of the time they ask the female, 30% of the time they ask one of the guys. So females are asked more. But maybe that's just because the girl is different from the two boys. Maybe she's a more focal player, and that's why you click on her. Well, we can figure that out by replacing one of the men and putting two girls in. Right, because then the male becomes the focal player. So let's see the clicking on the male go up. Do they get tapped more? So this is where we have two females and one male. What we see instead is that the number of clicking on the male goes down. Women are still being clicked 40% of the time. So across the board, if we look at the, if it was sort of randomly distributed, it's easily rejected that this is not randomly distributed. So one of the ways you can see it is if you look overall for each of these individuals, how many times did people click on you? As you can see, all the women are clicked more than the men. Okay, so they're asked a lot more. Now the question is it a good thing to click on the females? So it's clear that the belief is there. The belief is there that the women will invest more. So is that what we see? Yes, it is definitely better to ask. It, also, we can ask who clicks on the females. Is it the males or is it the males and females both click the females more? Okay, there are no differences. If you come in and you see three people and there's a female there, it doesn't matter if you're male and female. You're gonna ask the female more frequently. Okay? Is it a good idea to ask the female? Yes. If you ask a female, she invests 76% of the time. If you ask a male, 50-50. Okay? So it's a good idea to ask the females because if you ask her, she will invest. Okay? So the net result of this is that at the end of the day, women continue to end up clicking the button a lot more than the males. Okay? So you can sort of say, what is it that we've found? Well, looking at the non-promotable test, not only are women reporting that they feel more uncomfortable when they're getting these non-promotable tasks put in front of them, but they will volunteer and they will take it upon themselves to perform the non-promotable task. Furthermore, they're asked more to do the non-promotable task, and when they're asked, they do it more frequently. So that's going to result in differential outcomes. So if you combine sort of both of these studies, what we're seeing on both sides is that the competition on one side can explain why men are more likely to end up with the promotable tasks, and the inability to say no is more likely to get the women stuck with the non-promotable task. Now, of course, the question is, what can we do about this? Why are we even concerned about it? Well, from the individual's perspective, if they're making mistakes that they don't enjoy, then we can point to these factors and hopefully help them improve. But from the corporate perspective, we want the best performing women to make it to the top, right? So if we're seeing these strange behaviors that are not optimal from a corporate perspective, then we can intervene in some way. I think it's quite difficult to really work much with the competition gap. It's a very long process. One of the things that we're seeing in competition is that it is resulting from the males being extremely overconfident. It's hard to say what to do about that because you have to go out and crush the males. None of us want to crush our little boys when they think they're fantastic, right? But it's not a question of boosting the girls because you don't want overconfident people either. So the competition side is difficult. It requires more institutional changes. But the allocation of the non-promotable task, I think there's actually quite a bit that we can do. Simple awareness, keeping track of how many nasty tasks you're doing in the workplace. I know that from the Kennedy School, every time you do serve on a committee or do something else, you get a point that can be counted against teaching. We have this notion that we should get equal representation of males and females in all committees, which is a wonderful notion. The only problem is if you only have 20% female faculty, the female faculty will be running around to committee meeting nonstop and never get promoted. Okay? So this notion that we can have equal representation of gender on committees, have same teaching load, same expectations for research, it doesn't add up. The institutions have to make a choice, right? So maybe if you want equal representation on committees, it would require hiring more female faculty. What I think is promising on the allocation of non-promotable tasks is this finding that it, in part, looks like it's driven by beliefs. It's because women are expected to step up to the task. Well, we can play with beliefs. If you start saying no, to just in the small, because we know that backlash can happen as well. Those things can change. But from an institutional perspective, it's certainly easy to fix. When I come into the dean's office, why does it have to be somebody who volunteers? Why don't we just put the names into a hat and draw one? Right? Why don't we just take turns Right? So there are many things that we can do about the allocation of the non-promotable task. It's not a question, it's a non-promotable task, anybody can do it. When I talk to people and say, well, the reason why we always send Kathleen to these committee meetings is that she's so good at it, okay? But maybe we should just try to send some of the other people and see how it goes. So I think the institutional changes and being aware of these allocations makes it easier. And certainly from the individual perspective, I think joining no clubs and drinking wine and thinking about why you say yes to some things when you really want to say no does make it easier to justify your no's. It's certainly thinking about what it is that you're implicitly saying no to every time you say yes makes it easier. So, thank you. So I think there was a Q&A, no?
Yeah,
no,
yeah. We take questions. Who would like to do sequentially or just take a few and?
Questions? Anybody? Okay, that's one.
Sorry about that. I'm not an economics student. In fact, I'm a social worker. But I wanted to ask, what sort of ramifications do you think this has in the workforce for productive workforces? What are the effects of this type of research, saying that women will do that in the outcomes economically and financially?
I'm not sure I heard the whole thing, sorry. I think I'll move out here.
Okay, can you hear me, sorry?
Yes.
So what do you think the outcome of this type of research is for the economics of our workforce? What is it costing us in our workforce?
So I don't know what the costs of it are. I know that a number of corporations in the US have diversity officers that are struggling very hard to find females to promote to move up. The fact that they're spending money to do that suggests that they're aware that there is a cost in not getting women promoted. So, you know, we're working under the assumption that the females, despite being of higher ability, are not succeeding. So I'm not going to give a number because it would be a silly number. I think the fact that we're seeing these differences in choices could have very substantial consequences. But obviously, if you end up having somebody else going in and getting promoted, it means that other people are not going to get promoted. So there will be somebody who wouldn't be so happy with it. Okay. But I don't know what the numbers are. Yeah, there's a question back there.
Thanks for your presentation. I see the things that you have explained, I see in my workplace, but I guess there's always a need to say yes to tasks and activities. Have you given thought or looked into how we get the males to say yes more so the females don't have to do that?
No, so that's exactly the right question, right? Because it's not, you want people to say yes. I think one of the ways to get the males to say yes more is by saying no, so that things go someplace else. Right? The reason why females are going to be asked more is if they always say yes. If you're rushed and you need somebody to do something, you're going to ask the person who's going to say yes. And if you start saying no more, I mean, you can't say no all the time, but becoming less of a yay sayer is going to force the allocation to go someplace else. So I think that's in part what we're seeing. It's not as if the males won't step up to the task, but if somebody else is doing it, you don't have to. So I think that's what we're seeing in the non-promotable. Okay.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. Sorry, excuse me. Have you looked into the characteristics of women who do actually make it into senior positions? And do they actually demonstrate some characteristics in being more selective in their tasks that they accept?
So we certainly see that the women who succeed are competitive and confident. The females I've spoken to who succeed actually claim that they're very good at saying no. We're doing a bunch of diary studies where we ask people to report how many times they were asked and how many times they said no. Looking at this whole aspect of saying no is a relatively new research agenda, and we have not gone out to look at female leaders, but certainly the female leaders we have spoken to report proudly that they're very good at saying no. We know that the competitive side, that when we look at people who have been in our laboratory who didn't enter the competition, in particular for women, so if we look at freshman women who have come into our study, don't enter the competition, their decision not to enter the competition predicts what kind of income they're going to have 5 years later. It does suggest that this leaning in does harm them in the future. Okay, there's a question over there. There is a question. There are many questions.
My turn?
Yeah.
I just wondered, perhaps I missed this, but do you have any evidence on whether women are more likely to decline requests from female managers than they are from male?
Okay, I didn't hear that either.
Sorry. Are women workers more likely to decline a request for a non-promotable task from a female manager than they are from a male manager?
No, so that's something that we're very interested in looking at, and that's a very relevant question. What we're seeing in the diary study, unfortunately, is that most people report getting requests from a male. So we just, in what we have so far, we don't have sufficient variation to identify whether or not there's a variation. What we see in our laboratory study is that if you are tapped by a female and you're a female, you're more likely to do it. But the laboratories, I'm not sure that is evidence of really what would be happening in the field in that domain. Yes, Jeff.
Well, thank you very much. It's a fascinating study.
Let's get a microphone.
I never used a mic. Thank you very much for a fascinating reporting of what you're finding. That one of the last things you said was about the ability to predict 5 years on. But as that gets known, do you think that will make the responses change? Will there be a feedback effect from it?
What is tricky is really. Having children myself, on one hand, we can see that being very competitive secures a higher income. On the other hand, if I think about the way that I want my children to become, becoming extremely competitive is not necessarily, so on one hand, I can say, well, if I make my children really competitive, they will have a higher income. But it's not obvious that that's what I necessarily want to train my children to do. It is much easier for me to say that we tend as parents to have this tendency to constantly tell our children that they can't say no. If you have made a rule as a parent, they have to accept that rule and say yes. And we don't really give them a lot of room to come back and say, that's a really silly rule, mommy. I'm going to say no. And as a stressed out parent, you say no, you cannot say no. But maybe sometimes saying, you're right, that is an absolutely silly rule. You can say no to that. So I think it's easier to give children a better perspective on the saying no to things that don't make sense than it is to say you should be overconfident and super competitive. Surely, having a good assessment of how good you are and being willing to take risk based on that ability is something that is admirable. But what we're seeing in the study is really that it's the extremely overconfident people who are entering a lot.
I may have misunderstood you, but all your experiments are inevitably driven by money, immediate rewards, and we know the problems with having small-scale experiments. You've never got anything of any great magnitude, in a sense. What I wanted to ask you was, is it relevant in the sense that the notion of psychic income, I mean, people are just driven by something a bit broader than just immediate small sums of money, in a sense. It's a criticism, obviously, of almost any experimental technique of this sort. Are women, you know, do they have a broader concept of psychic income than men, or is that not a question you've been looking at?
You know, obviously what we're doing with the monetary incentives in the laboratory is that we want to incentivize people and we hope to control for it. But, you know, part of the reason why we take things into a laboratory is that we can look at other environments as well. So, given the limited time here today, looking at, for example, the competition, we have one environment in which you enter the competition and get paid. Then we have another environment where you just submit a past performance. So you don't actually have to go in and compete, right? And what we're seeing is that women are willing to do that, but they're not willing to step into the competition itself. So it's true that there might be other things going on, but because we're within the laboratory setting, we can control for some of the other things that are going on to help us identify, yes, this is indeed a reluctance to put yourself in a competitive environment. But it's always an issue, and that's precisely why, you know, on one hand, we can start in the laboratory and identify behaviors, and we can identify the source of the behavior, but then when we subsequently can go out and say, okay, we identified this behavior in the laboratory, but it's predictive of the majors that people go into, of their future incomes, then it's hard just to say, maybe there was something else that was motivating their behavior. Maybe it was because they knew that you wanted to find this, but then it's would be surprising to see that it actually carries over in subsequent human capital investments. Okay, this question up here.
As someone who's always made a deliberate choice to avoid being on committees,
congratulations.
I've always thought that was a career-limiting move for myself because it appeared to me, and this is only anecdotal, I have no research on it, that the people who are on committees are more obvious and seem to sometimes obtain promotion that people who aren't on committees don't because they're in the background doing the work. So I was just interested in your thoughts on that.
Well, so it obviously depends on what kind of work environment you're in. In economics, all we care about publications. In the top five journals, that's what we care about. Coming up for promotion to associate professor, nobody will ask how many committees did you serve on. They will say, did you serve on one committee? Yes, then we're good. Okay, so I think being on committees lead to more committees. So if that's the promotion, I don't see people being promoted for their academic accomplishments, at least at the University of Pittsburgh, because of their committee service. But somebody obviously has to be on committee, so it's not to say, it just doesn't have to be the same people all the time, and maybe waiting a while until you've established your career is a good idea.
We'll take one last question. The person at...
Okay.
But so after the that person has been ignored longer.
Thank you. I'm interested in.
We'll come back to you.
Oh, sorry. I'm interested in the definition of a non-promotable task, and I think that my problem with that is that it undermines some work which is fundamental to organisations and operation. And I think it's become a danger that you devalue the wrong types of task and over-promote the types of tasks that you define as promotable, and that undermines women. Because if women are choosing non-promotable tasks because they see them as essential to proper functioning, then that ought to be a promotable task. And I'm wondering whether we can change that dialogue and that language.
You know, it would be wonderful if we could change that, because there are clearly tasks that need to be done. But the problem with the non-promotable tasks is that they're typically tasks that anybody can do. So if you're going to look in an organization and figure out who to promote, if it's a task that anybody can do, you can't promote somebody who's performed a task that anybody can do, right? So clearly it's something that has to be done within the organization. So it's not as if it's not valued, but we need to get the non-promotable task equally distributed across people so that they all have to have the same opportunities to demonstrate their excellence on the promotable tasks. Okay. But let's get the question over here.
We are the first generation of women who are independent. I believe that if you repeat your experiments in 10 years or 20 years, the results will be dramatically different, don't you?
I wish I did. I think what is particularly disturbing for me here is these are freshman women. You know, these behaviors are seen in 18 and 19 year olds when they first start college. So it is not men and women who have been in the labor market for a long time, who have gotten used to taking on non-promoted. This is the prime of the crop that we should be seeing 10 years from now. And they haven't even started, and they're already now clicking that silly little red button, okay? So I wish that you were, I hope you're right. Okay. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for coming in such great numbers. We had to change the venue to accommodate the interest, increased interest in our lecture today. And please join me in thanking Professor Vesterlund for a great talk and the Q&A that followed.